Good morning. Welcome to everybody who's joining us on the live stream this morning as well. It's good to have you all together with us this morning to pray. There's interesting ancient burial customs where they used to add material things, leave them in the tomb or in the casket. They believed they were things that someone might need for the next life, or they were things to reveal to the gods the status of this person on earth. The pyramids are great examples of this, filled with treasures that are still there, unused. Because as we know, you can't take it with you, as our popular line reminds us about our attachment to material things. And the gospel today can be a message about our attachments that come with a warning from the Lord. If our desire, our perceived need for material wealth owns us, it can potentially destroy us and has eternal consequences. And so for a question that we can ask ourselves today is, who or what owns you? What owns us? And it is an answer that only our own prayerful and honest self-evaluation can reveal that answer. In reality, St. Paul reminds us by some of the words that he was speaking today of this verse, and also in 1 Corinthians, you are not your own. You were bought with a price. He's talking about the work that the Lord has done for us in our salvation. And we see that in our baptism, in our tonsuring, where the cutting of our hair is a symbol of slavery, meaning that we as a slave are obedient to our master, and our master is Christ, who becomes our master at baptism. And if we do not live like Christ is our owner, like our master, then we need to think about making a change. How shocking for this young man who most likely had a life without many struggles due to his privilege, and so he felt pretty sure about his good status. But he leaves sad because he has discovered something deep and troubling about himself, and that is that his possessions owned him completely. So should there be cause and despair for all of us in this land of plenty and land of excess that we live in America? And I would say despair, no, but self-evaluation and change, yes. Most people, almost everybody, is searching for meaning and significance in their life. They want their life to make a difference. And we often look for life, unfortunately, sometimes in the wrong places. We look for it in material things, in status and power. But what we must realize is this message from Luke that Jesus offers to us when he says one thing is needful in the story of Mary and Martha, who were in their house because Jesus was there and Martha was distracted with all of her tasks of serving and her sister Mary was not helping her. Jesus says to her, one thing is needful. Mary has chosen the good portion that will not be taken away from her. And what is that good portion? That good portion was to sit at the feet of Christ and listen to his teaching. Yet we all find it hard to learn this lesson because we become so distracted, so troubled, so anxious about so many material things. And this is not just about money. Materialism has nothing to do with the amount. It has everything to do with the attitude. This is about being rich in any preoccupation or goal or sinful passion that becomes more central in our lives than God as the source of our life. And if we can choose that good portion of Christ and we hold on to that, we keep him as a reference point from which we make all our decisions about money, power, material things, our leisure time, our relationships, Chances are better that we will make decisions that keep us from falling into distraction and self-centeredness. This is serious business because we're talking here about all those things that we do in our everyday life, our attitudes. And so it can become something that permeates all the things that we do. Daily, we make choices that affect our spiritual health and our ability to encounter God. Yet God is loving and merciful. And yes, He is these things, but He offers us a serious lesson about the things that can stand in the way of our connection to Him. This advice to this young man was spot on, and it's advice that we can all relate to as well in our own lives. This young man left sad, not necessarily condemned, but sad because his vision of himself was deflated. He thought that he had it all together. And please understand that God is not trying to trip us up on some kind of technicality. He wants all of us to be found in Him and with Him, all of us to be saved. But He offers this warning against our complacency. So we must do the work of self-examination, allowing the Spirit to help us to know the state of our soul, to acknowledge our weak spots, to be aware of the areas where we are susceptible to sin and those things that we make more important than God, and then attend to those struggles in those areas of our life. Confession and accountability with our spiritual father are an important tool provided by our Orthodox tradition. These are adult topics, and they're mature actions that we approach in a mature way as we are striving towards growth, employing awareness of our struggle to follow Jesus' example of self-emptying, of self-sacrifice, as we too seek to live lives of love and service to others. We're not alone in this sacred effort. As St. Paul wrote, we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. The community in which we live and pray and practice our Christian faith, the community of saints who pray for us, we all have to do this hard work that St. Paul spoke about today, that he labored hard for the gospel. Most importantly, we have to remember that God is great, that God is merciful, that his disciples ask him, then who can be saved? They give this impossible example. Jesus gives this impossible example of a camel going through the eye of a needle, which is either a literal example, which is impossible, of course, or the example of a large piece of rope that was called a camel going through the eye of a needle. In any case, he's given this example of something that seems impossible. But even in the face of our own inconsistent efforts to love and to serve God, what seems impossible for us is possible for God. St. Paul speaks of God's unspeakable and limitless grace. And he says, I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But in the epistle this morning, it says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And he means that he's a changed man by God's abundant grace, that he has gone from a persecutor of Christ to an apostle and a servant of Christ. So God can do great and seemingly impossible things with each of us, unworthy as we are, attached to our possessions. He does all this if we are willing to engage in the struggle to be free, to belong only to Christ as our master. Then we can know the amazing freedom and the joy of the kingdom, both in this life and in the next life as well. Important for us to remember, do not ever give up in this struggle. Always remember these words from this gospel today, that what is impossible for man is not impossible, is possible for God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.